Greetings and welcome to yet another episode of the Grog Pod Roguelike Podcast, where each episode of this podcast we descend from orbit and land on a barren, desolate roguelike game, big or small, late or like, depending on the definition of the day, depending on how we're feeling or how the dice is rolled. And we try to rank these in the pantheon of other games that we've talked about in previous episodes as, I guess, as best we can, while fighting off waves of cannibalistic raiders in the process. I am your host of said podcast, a plushy muffalo stuffed animal, Scott Berger. And landing with me on this godforsaken hellscape of a planet, with me in their own escape pods, are my co-hosts.
This is Will, the rare Thrumbo. So you're going to need at least a level 20 training if you want to have a chance of taming me.
And this is Andrew Harshman reporting in from whatever barren wasteland we've landed on. I am, of course, the space colonist's pet that gets turned into shish kebabs within the first 7 days of the play period.
And I'm Colin, your Arctic settler who managed to capture a Thrumbo in a room and slowly starve it slash shoot it to death so my colony could eat.
Yes, well, welcome returning listeners and maybe a swath of new listeners who might be joining the podcast since my non-stop shilling of it on the most recent roguelike celebration event, where I was lucky enough to be selected as a guest speaker to be talking about my talk title at the time, the quote, data science of roguelikes, where we had all sorts of fun deep dives into the data. Where do we get the data? What does the data say about stuff? And I'll post, I guess they haven't split it out into individual videos yet. They just have like the day one, day two, like 8 hour live streams. Maybe I'll dump a timestamp from that into the show notes. But once that standalone video gets put up, I think I'll probably just put that up here as well. But part of that discussion was that roguelikes are an enormous genre. There's, in fact, earlier today, we've had yet another reset the counter, boys, moment of people coming into the roguelike Discord asking what the definition is. So you might be clicking on this episode and going, huh? Rimworld? You got some explaining to do. So I think we've talked about in our episode just previous to this one, what is the extent of what makes a rogue game or rogue not game, light or like, or all that nonsense?
Rogue dark.
Yeah, this is roguelikes after dark is this episode. So let's jump right into it. Our episode this week, which I think is probably succinctly put as an MBA program in video game form, Rimworld, originally released on way back, I think we're almost closing in on the 10-year anniversary from the early PC Kickstarter of Rimworld, November 2013, released on Steam, I guess, 5 years later, October 2018, and believe it or not, available on consoles, PlayStation and Xbox One, from July 2022 onwards. This Rimworld was published and developed by Ludian Studios, based out in Ottawa, Canada, our neighbors to the north, and founded by someone who I'm 100% sure this is like a D&D name generated name and or a Rimworld alias, founded by Tynan Sylvester in 2013. It's a very D&D name. And where this game would roll up in our data set, if it landed on our data set, it's, I guess we'll get into it in a minute, but this game is not explicitly tagged as a roguelike per se, but if it was, if it did land on our data set, it would be the number 7 most popular rogue big hand gesture cloud
lights. We say rogue light, right?
Sure. Yeah, I think like,
yes.
Yeah, I think if Dwarf Fortress is enough to be canonized as like an honorary rogue, I think that kicks open the floodgates for Rimworld as well. So if this one were to fall into our data set, it would be the number 7 most popular rogue type game with 168,618. Nice kind of palindromic number there. Total reviews. Will, colonist is about to snap, and you have to describe this game in one sentence to keep them sane.
It's a top-down colony management simulation game.
There you go.
Very succinctly.
I'm glad you didn't call on me.
Is it fancy enough?
Well, there's a lot more depth to it than that, but you want one sentence, that's the sentence. It's also, you know, one of the top three greatest games of all time, in my opinion. Obviously, so that's the correct opinion. And I was so glad that I was very glad that I got the pick. I've been wanting to play this game for so long. I played it again, I should say. I played it. I think I put 520 hours into it within like the time of between getting it and like, I don't know, like a few years ago. And I know they came up with a whole bunch of new DLC. I hadn't played any of the royalty DLC, the ideology, the biomechanics or the robotics or
biotech,
genetics.
I think it's just
biotech. Yeah.
Biotech, that's it.
And so even in the recent playthroughs, in the past, what, we've had 2 weeks or so, I think, Colin, you were just saying, you were looking at my Steam, and it was like 40 plus hours in the past 2 weeks. And I can't even, I wish I could give you an evaluation of the DLC, but I have had so little experience with it, which is to say that, like, there's just so much content in this game that, like, I've had several colonies, for instance, and, like, just that died off very quickly. The first one, there was a pregnancy, which is new to me. And in the one that I've been playing for the last 40 hours, no pregnancy. And so you're just like, you may or may not come across many of the major aspects of the DLC just because there's just so much other stuff going on. And it's incredibly complex and the replayability is so high. It's just, oh my God. If you haven't played Rimworld, you're missing out. I'm envious of you because you get the experience of getting to play it for the first time.
Mm-hmm. So you said Colony Sim, or I think, yeah, we've touched on Colony Sim. What separates this from something like a Sim Ant, or I'm struggling to think of some other Colony Sims, like
20 years.
Well, I don't think that this game, unlike Sim Ant, it's not available in my sixth grade shop class. they don't have RimWorld installed on those Mac computers. Yeah, what is the difference? I haven't had a whole lot of colony simulator experience.
In my opinion, they have a lot of the similar mechanics where everything is being simulated in real time, and the difference for me in this one is it's got a very compelling narrative that I love, but also there is just so much depth to like all the different characteristics. Like just take one characteristics like temperature, for instance, and temperature is a major part in the game. As someone, Colin would say this, as someone who's playing in the Arctic, like your yes. Pawns will start to like get hypothermia. They'll start to collect all these different status effects, these mood losses when they sleep in the cold. And when it's too hot, they have the opposite. They can catch on fire. And so just with temperature and needing to freeze things, and like certain things will rot at certain temperatures. And like, there's just so much complexity around all that stuff, but it all follows what you would expect, I think. So it's a very good, I think, approximation of what the world is as we know it, which is something I really appreciate, because it's not inventing a whole bunch of, well, it is inventing some new things, but for the most part, the world as we know it like makes a lot of sense. You get shot in the arm, you have an arm wound, and suddenly your manipulation percent goes down. And so like a lot of that stuff just is very intuitive. If you have someone who's a very good doctor and they patch up that arm, there's a good chance that you won't get infected. Or if you have a sterile environment, that you won't get infected. But if you're, you know, patching it up in the middle of like blood and guts and people's vomits, there's a good chance you'll get infected, die from the infection, and all that fun stuff. So that level of depth and complexity, I think, really just adds so much to the game.
Yeah, and I mean, I think I'm sure that there were games before, but the colony simulator is, of course, Dwarf Fortress.
Yeah.
And I think that RimWorld is the successor, and I don't want to say culmination, but it is the one that first truly polished off Dwarf Fortress and made it into a playable version. Like, I think it takes a lot of the brutality of Dwarf Fortress, the true like losing is fun options. Like, I think most of the other colony sims that came before, something like Prison Architect, like you didn't really you didn't lose. And like the only reason I could say RimWorld is a colony simulator is absolutely possible to lose. I lost multiple runs trying to survive in the Arctic, which is my preferred method of playing for some reason, including one where they didn't even make it past the first night. I decided to build too far away from where they started, and they all froze to death while trying to carry supplies to the new like place they were going to build. So,
yeah. So I have a bullet point in here that maybe we'll keep expanding on these comparisons with Dwarf Fortress. That for it feels like to me, Rimworld is like the Warcraft 3 to Dwarf Fortress's Starcraft. Does that sound right? Is that too analogous? Am I digging too deep?
I have no idea what you mean by that.
What I mean is like more. Maybe I'm just reiterating what Colin just said, like a more polished sort of like user friendly. Maybe I'm thinking of just like the map editor and specifically, but like, yeah, I think I'm just going to like, yeah, echo Colin's point that it for my love of Dwarf Fortress, it does feel like Rimworld is the more streamlined, polished version. Maybe I'll stop there.
Yeah.
That's
I can see where you. I can see a little bit where the comparison is. Like, Dwarf Fortress is a little bit grittier. It's definitely a lot jankier. StarCraft, the original StarCraft, had a good deal of jank in it. And then you know, when Warcraft 3 came along, the graphics are a little cutesier. Both great games, in both categories, both comparisons.
Yeah, but being able to click things. And that's I mean, we talked about this in the past, like how big a deal like that UI and the ability, like with Cataclysm, for instance, being the most recent, like that was abysmal to play. And this was a relative delight. And if only that that game had this interface. I mean, it's got a lot of similar properties. It's like a large tile-based simulation. If that game had like this game's graphics and the ability to click things, I bet you I would fucking love Cataclysm. Mm-hmm. That seems to be what missed there. But like this game, it's just got it all.
Or even literally Dwarf Fortress. Like the new Steam release came further, but like I think that Dwarf Fortress thematically makes more sense than Rimworld, which is a weird space western, and you kind of have to hand wave away. Like, why are you living in this planet? Why can't you just like have normal houses? Why are people trying to cannibalize you? But also I have space guns.
I feel like that's maybe my biggest criticism of the game is the theme. But maybe before jumping into that, we'll jump into like how does this game begin? So in our typical Our Story Begins segment, we have...
Oh, wait, I know this one. Brotato has crash landed on a planet. Oh, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, so you have to generate the potato planet first, and by doing so, well, even before doing that, you have I need to call this out every time that I find it, the tutorial option. This game's tutorial, I think, is really good, but maybe not super good, because I feel like it gives you like, you know, the kind of like keys to the playground. You're like, okay, yeah, I think I can get bootstrapped and started here. And then as soon as the tutorial is like, okay, you think you like you're behind the driver's seat of the car that you're driving for the first time. All right, good luck. Hop on the freeway. You're like, oh my God, oncoming traffic kind of a deal. Generally, I feel like when we come across a game with a good tutorial, it's worth calling out. I think Rimworld has a good tutorial mode.
Well, we're back after the evil Comcast destroyed our first colony. Scott, you were talking about the tutorial.
Yes, in typical roguelike fashion, you know, whenever we have to restart the recording, maybe let's just start the whole podcast over again. I'm your host, Scott Berger. No. yeah, so I think the tutorial mode in this game is good. Andrew, this was
good, but not great. I believe you were quoted as saying.
And I don't know what a great tutorial would be. Like, does it need to handhold me all the way to the end? Probably not. But Andrew, did you do the tutorial?
Well, I absolutely did the tutorial. I did the tutorial twice because I could not get my little meeples cooking. And I'm not exactly sure what happened. It felt like the game was soft locked, but I'm sure I messed something up. And upon restarting the tutorial and making sure I was following the procedure step by step, very, very to the letter, it went through. And yeah, I did play it. Thoughts are that it's good, not great, indeed. I felt like it gave me enough, it gave me the basics, enough to play the game. I was, you know, doing a fair amount of Googling, and I watched a few videos, and I was kind of dismayed initially. Oh no, I gotta teach myself a game again, like with Cataclysm. Oh no, I don't want to do this. I just want to sit down and play a game. And then I'd keep getting distracted by like more brainless like FPS games and stuff. It seems that I'm on a perpetual, like, you know, retro shooter kick. But when I would come back, you know, I the tutorial did a decent job of putting that information in my brain. One thing that I'm either like forgot because a decent amount of time passed since I like successfully completed the tutorial and actually like, you know, sunk a decent amount of time into a run, was, so either I forgot that it mentioned this or the tutorial doesn't mention it, that like in the tutorial mode, it, your crops grow like uber fast. And so like my first couple of runs kept getting like kind of bogged down, and I ended up like restarting because the crops were growing so slowly in comparison to the tutorial. And I'm like, why are they going so slow? Why is the percentage stopping when the sun goes down?
Oh, yeah.
Well, obviously, you know, it's not like in the tutorial at all. What's the deal? And then, like, I thought, well, maybe I picked a different part of the globe than like in the tutorial, and so I restarted it again. And then
yeah,
I then
just
I start, finally realized,
start in
oh,
the
no,
Arctic,
just,
where it's sunny all the time.
Yeah. So I don't know if that's necessarily a failing of the tutorial, but yeah, there's just I guess an example of how like the tutorial can't quite, you know, cover everything. Mm. And yeah, I mean, as I started trying to like tech up and stuff, it would have been nice if those things had been covered. It's, yeah, it's tough to say. I was kind of surprised that for a fully released 1.0 game that's like so popular and was like in production, like early access or whatever for so long, that there wasn't, I was surprised when I got to the end of the tutorial, basically. I was like, oh, really? That's all? Oh, okay. I've been told this game is incredibly granular and deep. I'm a little worried that the tutorial took 10 minutes.
But is so, I mean, luckily we have two Rimworld experts with us who can.
Rimsperts?
Experts on rimming here.
Yeah.
Who can tell us which of the AI storytellers we should pick that could really just like hold our hands for us new people to get the most optimal play experience.
I only play on the standard person.
Yeah, you should do the class. I think it's the classic, and then like the one of the, not the first level of difficulty, but like the second or third probably.
Hmm.
I think it's I believe it's something like a 7-point scale for difficulty.
Mm-hmm.
Whichever one is right above Strive to Survive, which is the like you're starting to actually make the game hard difficulty, which is the one I like.
Yeah, that Strive to Survive is the one that, like, coming back into it, I think that's the most, like, fun, where, like, yeah, there's some challenge, but, like, you definitely want to have some difficulty, but, like, it's not overwhelming. Like, I didn't want to have to reset the colony a bunch of times. I've already done the lessons learned, and so, like, that's the thing that you guys are going through right now. I know, especially, like, Scott, you demonstrated what your colony looked like to me, and I'm just like, oh, my goodness, this is interesting to see, like, oh, yeah, I guess wood walls... They are something. They help you in the beginning, but flammability is a lesson you learn very well.
Well, there's a big difference for... So if people are coming to this game from Dwarf Fortress, like, the number one thing is that this is all... As far as I know, maybe I'm like, my mind is yet to be open, but... So this game is all on just one Z level, so like one floor, if you will. So you can't dig down deep into the nice, cozy ground and be like, all right, well, I'm just going to dig out like room by room what I want here. You have to be very diligent with like, oh, I'm gonna be like going around and like I guess mining these like surface deposits of rock and stuff, and then building out my base on the surface here. And your colonists are smart enough to at least put roofs on things. But yeah, I was like, oh, well, I have to like completely reset my Dwarf Fortress mindset into like it's a similar but different approach of how you do this, like same kind of colony management space.
Did either of you guys get killed by the bugs?
No.
As a deep, like building your colony dug deep within the rocks is extremely dangerous way to play. The insects, the weird insectoids will...
Infestation is what the event is called.
Yeah. They will eventually spawn in your base and you will have like the giant insect creatures spawn inside your base, inside of all of your defenses, and it is extremely hard to get them out.
So, which is interesting because in my brain space, I'm thinking like, okay, it's a similar idea with Dwarf Fortress.
All right. So I guess we were talking about digging too deep.
Indeed. Yeah. Unfortunately, listeners, there was an escape pod mishap, and Scott has been jettisoned down to the planet's surface. So he is remote, and he might sound a little tin canny.
He's calling in over the comm station.
Right. So AI storytellers, I think, is a big aspect of this game. That's something you don't get with your Dwarf Fortress. It's something you don't get with your Frostpunks. But it sounds like Colin and Will, you only play with Cassandra Classic and not really with Phoebe Chillax or Randy Random at all.
Okay. Right? Well, I'll add this caveat, like never the Chillax one. I have no interest in low difficulty. Low difficulty is the most boring thing. Maybe if you really want to learn how to cook and that's like something you need to focus on without other distractions, but like difficulty makes the game fun. And so oftentimes like in previous playthroughs, I mean, I've had many, many, many over the 580 hours, but like the Randy Random is one of my favorite things. Because when you have like 50 cats, like just pop onto your screen and they all suddenly join your colony. Like that's an event that can happen in any case, but like that happening after some other like positive, like you could have multiple negative things happening, multiple positives. It's like, it's just completely crazy. And it's that makes it much more, well, difficult, but like fun to have to mitigate. And so if you do the maximum difficulty on Randy Random, then you're in for like just a zany time, and it can be like super fun to do that style of playthrough, just knowing that it can go sideways very quickly.
Yeah, I think random events is is something that I appreciate in games, and makes for a lot of fun, especially after the game when you're, you know, evangelizing on behalf of a game that you've played. You can tell folks about, oh, here's the unique situation that played out in my game and how these random scenarios came together to form a unique, fun narrative. And I think it also sort of, despite that not being something that was present in like the original game Rogue, it speaks to the sort of the forebearers of the Rogue genre and the like Dungeons and Dragons-ness. The Dungeons and Dragons themes that are present in throughout roguelike games. In, you know, original Dungeons and Dragons, there's a lot of random encounters and random tables and things of that nature. And so it's cool to kind of see that reflected in games like this.
Well, it's not actually like random, like in the sense that like, well, I mean, obviously like it's pulling from a pool of possible events, but what I think is really interesting about like the base difficulty is that like it tries to do the balance of the positive and negative events, but then it also uses your total wealth as essentially the thing that calibrates the scale and the magnitude of all the events. And so if you have lots of colonists and lots of wealth accumulated in your colony, you'll get like a horde of like 50 guys attacking you and like on a raid. And it doesn't, and it like make sure that like when you're first starting, you get like just maddened animals, and then as you get a little further along, there's a guy with a little knife. But like, so the difficulty ramps pretty closely with your overall ability in the game in terms of the kind of your static defense and all that fun stuff. And so I just really appreciate it's so good at self-balancing into that super fun corridor between on that scale of difficulty and skill. And so I think that it's really it's a very nice attribute of this game, as opposed to like a Dwarf Fortress or other games, which just they don't care. They just like, here's the punishment hammer and it's landed on your face.
Yeah, I'm not usually super into difficulty sliders and stuff like that, but I feel like it works well for RimWorld because it's such a malleable game. You can really customize how you want the experience to be. You can absolutely make this more or less of a roguelike based off of your difficulty curve that you choose and how you want it to throw things at you. You can, like, at the one end, it's like getting to the end of this season will be a difficult task, and at the other end, it's I'm building a SimCity style thing where I'm pretty sure I'm going to survive. There will be challenges that are thrown at me that will influence how my game progresses, but I won't be at like true risk of losing it all. But you could still have a great time. I look at something like Factorio, where like I don't really ever feel like I'm going to lose something like Factorio or SimCity, but it's still a great game. You could do the same thing with RimWorld if you wanted.
On the one hand, permadeath, like, and not being able to save, it's not like a default. It is a conscious like choice you make when you start a new colony. So one might argue that, well, maybe that's not the most roguelike, but it's kind of counterbalanced, I feel like, by the fact that it is very much a run-based game. Mm-hmm. And like seeing how far you get with a given colony under, you know, whatever circumstances and whatever, you know, the narrator you know, picks for you is very much, it seems like, a focus of the game.
And it seems like there is, I guess, technically a tangible goal that you're reaching towards in that. So your story begins, you know, you have all these different kind of scenarios to pick from. And one of them, I think this is the tutorial one, is that your colony ship has broken apart and there's only three survivors that land on the planet. And, you know, it's not explicitly stated, but basically your victory condition for the game, and Will and Colin, correct me if I'm wrong, is basically to build a spaceship and just get off the planet. Is that right?
Yeah, that's the default one. There's several more now, but yeah, that's what a lot of people aim for.
It's like that Tom Hanks film.
Yeah, either build a ship to get off, find the other ship that's already there and defend for a while. If you have the DLC, you can become like an imperial noble person and they'll come like pick you up once they like you enough. There's another, you can be like a, become like a tech robot god or something. I haven't really explored that one yet, but.
So yeah. Colin, when you and Will are embarking on a new adventure in RimWorld, like, do you have like a specific goal in mind? Like, okay, like I'm going to do this like every time, or is it like, oh, I'm going to fire up a new run in RimWorld to do something different?
I'm usually trying to do some sort of weird scenario. So like, I feel like I can't remember the last time I did a, let's just have like a couple of normal people on a temperate map with no weirdness going on. I'm always either in the Arctic or the desert or permanent eclipse, or like, I'm just going to click random on everything and see where I end up and go from there. So it's like, maybe I'll be a jungle. Who knows? Maybe like all my colonists might be incredibly bad to start with because I won't choose the best ones. And I feel like it's more interesting to try to do a themed scenario of some sort.
I'm the complete opposite.
Will's, yeah.
Yeah, no, I want, the game for me is beating the difficulty level. And so I want to choose all the optimal conditions I possibly can and have the only thing that I'm striving against not be like the shittiness of my pawns or the location I land. I want the only thing that I'm fighting against to be the highest level of difficulty. Well, that's like historically been like my goal with this game. And now that I feel like I accomplished that, it's like, well, now what else can I do? And for this game, I really want to explore the DLC. And so I set the difficulty a little lower because I just didn't want to get absolutely wrecked right away. And my goal is kind of like, well, I want to stay alive long enough to like experience DLC. So I kind of made it like, well, I'm going to build an optimal base. And in the past, I've done, you know, a lot of analysis around optimal base design. And for this run, I think I did another like 20 hours of like outside the game, like research into Well, you know, room sizes have changed since the optimal room sizes have changed, insulation conditions have changed, how much beauty, what kind of flooring has changed. So I had to do a lot of research into, like, well, what's the proper structure? Obviously, it's all based around the central freezer. How many AC units do I need to, you know, all these things, all these considerations, hallways, all the electricity and defenses and the kill boxes. It's all a very intricate puzzle. And to put it all together in such a satisfying way when you're playing the game live and it's all coming together and it's working out just like you planned and your defenses are holding against these big raids. Oh, it's just so satisfying. And yeah, I'm right now just talking about it. I feel my excitement to like play Rimworld, like building in me. And I'm like, oh my God, my colony right now. I know where it's at. And like, I know what my objectives are. I just got the comms console. The drug production's just started. So I need to start selling that flake. Oh my God, it's the get rich phase. The get rich phase is like when things really take off.
Oh yeah, I forgot about how every Rimworld colony does end up devolving into you just being like a Columbia drug lord producer.
Right. That's my big gripe, I think, is that like the optimal play invariably is being a drug lord. Because the manufacturer of that, specifically the drug flake, is the most lucrative thing you can do in the game. And turns out money is a really good replacement for pretty much any skill that your pawns need, or like any like deficiencies you have. If your gear is really shitty and you don't have a good, you know, you don't have a good artist, so you don't have any good art, like you just buy all that shit. And you need some medicine, buy all that shit. And so flake is just the thing that turns into all the things you need to win.
Just like in the real world.
Yeah.
And drugs. At that point, why would you even want to leave your colony? Why would you want to escape on a ship? Just hang out
that's a great
Vice City space mansion. Interesting. Well, Will, I'm not going to argue with you at all. You paint a beautiful picture, and I think this will be reflected in my very much in my ranking. You paint a beautiful picture. I sense your excitement. It is palpable. It inspires me to play this game a bit more, to go back to it and continue to keep at it. But sadly, I think just my brain works differently. And I think that the Rimworld is a very good game. It is a very good game, but sadly, it's just kind of not my type of game.
I have a solution though for you.
Oh,
before you like, you know, it sounds like you're kind of putting it aside and all that fun, but like, let me off, like, prepare carefully is a mod for the game, and it's a mod carefully. I think yeah, so Rimworld, I think after Slay the Spire, it's the game I put the most in time in, like, and there's about I think 800 different like children, no, 300 different like children backstories, and I think 500 different adult backstories, and each of these things has like specific attributes that lead to like the total sum of the adult properties. And what Prepare Carefully allows you to do is to select these things. And so the reason I say this is like, oh, that sounds really annoying. Well, I would hate to have to select from all these things in order to come up with people. But what you can do though is you can create your friends. And when you have your friends in the game,
yeah.
And you basically try and match their abilities to the abilities of the characters, you know, some kind of in a kind of a more of a abstract sense. But like then suddenly, you know, you're running around and Colin, he's on the front line and he just got a fucking headshot and he just lost like his left eye. You care a lot more. You start to like your investment in like, oh, wow, looks like Colin just fell in love with maybe there's another, some other person that you know in your life and they fell in love and they get married organically in the game. And it's just this happy story of how they have kids. And it's just a really fun way of doing it.
It's like The Sims. Yeah. But
you can be like Geordi LaForge of Star Trek.
Right. No, I've made that colony where everyone was, I've had Picard, Worf, and like I chose my prepare carefully. Excellent. It was the whole crew down there. Every time someone would join to be a new TNG character, and like,
that's a very fun and enjoyable idea. But what I was referencing was when Geordi like starts hitting on like a holodeck, like replication of some famous engineer. And then, like, later they get, anyway, they get, like, married? Ugh, what a terrible situation.
They don't get married.
Anyway.
She was married.
Don't they? I thought later, like, canonically in the movies, they get hit.
No, she was already married.
Are we sure? Okay.
I am quite certain. I've seen this episode in the last
hologram.
And that maybe
the hologram was married?
Well,
she was a real person. She was the person that built these the Enterprise's engines. And so he needed her help to solve the situation with the radiation. They would fall into a trap. It doesn't matter, you know, apparently I know way too much about TNG, I'm realizing, but,
but
I don't know her name though. So
I'm still unclear on if he fell in love with the hologram or
the hologram.
Okay. But the hologram was married
to
a different hologram.
The real person the hologram was based on was married.
Mm.
Holy moly.
But the hologram was single.
The hologram was very single, very eligible, in fact. And she was very into him. So, you know, that's where the immoral problem arises.
Yes. So basically, what you're saying is you make it like The Sims, where you make your friends in Sims. But then if they die, you can turn their skin into human leather chairs and you can eat their flesh.
Yeah, they're still useful.
I'm curious.
So the meme that I see a lot on the intranets is that, like, the internet would have you believe that Rimworld is, like, first a colony simulator, but second an orgist harvesting business simulator. So how essential is that to you two veteran players' operations?
It's very important to YouTube. I mean, like, as soon as you're like your main, your you know, the screen shows cannibalism is the best way, or like, ooh, fresh baby meat, the only way to live. Like, you know that you're that's gonna get some clicks. And I'm still really excited about, there's an ideology where you want to, it's cannibalistic, and baby meat gives you an extra, like, mood boost. And so I'm really looking forward to that fresh baby meat in the next playthrough.
And, then, and that's, of course, the speedrun strat to become the space monarch and then have a ship come pick you up.
Yeah. I've never engaged in that. You have to specifically, like, hunt out colonists that have that trait, because if you don't, like, shocker, most people don't want to be cannibals. This is true in game as well. If you cannibalize people in the game with a normal pawn, they're very upset.
They're just unworthy. Then they'll die, they'll have a mood break, and then your cannibals will eat him.
Yeah. We have not talked about mood breaks, which are frequent and almost excessive.
Which, like, I imagine, I'll let you expound upon it and quit interrupting, but perhaps that is part of the fun, in that, like, you know, when you get comparable, when you get proficient in a game, you want it to be more difficult, to be more engaging. To me, at, like, my level of play, it just kind of feels like a babysitter simulator. And it's like, I don't, why do I have to manage these people's moods? But part of the issue is just the frustration with, like, not quite understanding all the systems and being like, well, I don't know why they're mad. Because the monkey got killed or whatever, the pet monkey, I should have realized ahead of time. Anyway, sorry, do continue. They happen too frequently, perhaps, you say?
I think that they happen... I feel like they're very all or nothing. They're like, I've gone on a murderous rampage. You're like, uh-oh. Well, I guess I should have let you eat on that table.
Well, it's also an important distinguisher between how Rimworld does these kind of mood effects versus Dwarf Fortress, where in Dwarf Fortress, if dwarves start getting into, like, a weird mood, they'll either, if their weird requirements are satisfied, they'll go and create some sort of unique work of art or some unique battle axe that has, like, menacing spikes on it or something cool. Whereas it does seem very much more in Rimworld, as far as I've played in, you know, the paltry 10-ish hours, 15 hours or so, that, yeah, this is like a system that you have to manage, but it's more of like, well, like, by the way that you manage their mood is kind of like the way that you're progressing the base anyway, in a sense, right?
Yeah.
Yep. Exactly. It's mood is just a resource you have to manage, and you eventually learn how to best do things. Like, you learn that, hey, everyone has to eat in a dining room. And so if you have an impressive dining room, everyone shares together in that +6 perk for having an impressive dining room. And so, oh yeah. Mm-hmm. And everyone likes to have their own bed. They don't like to be interrupted when they sleep. They like to be in the right temperature. And so there's a lot of, like, base things you start to learn about, oh, I can just get rid of most of the negative attributes just by having, like, a reasonable base. And then, you know, for the extra times when people are, you know, having, they lost, you lost the pet unexpectedly, shit happens, that's why you have a bunch of smoke leaf just ready to go. And so you set you give them a drug policy which says, if your mood is below 30% or your recreation is below 30%, just go light up, just chill out, you know, come back, you know, slow down your work, just take it easy, and then you're gonna be good to go.
Sure. Yeah, use substances to regulate your mood. Just like
it's just like real life. Like I said, it's a perfect simulation.
Oh, that's very very entertaining indeed. Yeah, good. What a deal. I do enjoy. We're I guess past this topic, but it's nice to hear how you can like really you know kind of customize your experience and give yourself different like end goals and stuff. Because sometimes I've encountered games similar to this, where it seems like the simulation is the point and that there's not like any goals to be really to achieve. But RimWorld, there you can make your own goals very easily, and it provides a lot for you as well. So I appreciate that they had the thought to like put in their goalposts for the players to reach, and quite a variety of them.
Yeah. No, go ahead, Scott.
Oh, yeah. So I think I might be kind of in the same sort of slump zone that Andrew is currently in, where Andrew was saying it kind of feels like a babysitter simulator. And I think I'm in that spot right now as well, because it doesn't, like, I still have all the muscle memory for, like, all right, Dwarf Fortress, like, land and expand, start building out all these workshops and stuff. And all right, the dwarves know what to do. And if I set up this workshop, some dwarf is going to go in there and start cranking away on stuff once I set that thing up. I think one of the things that's kind of unclear to me, even after the tutorial, which I thought taught me how to do this, but then, Will, you looked at my base on the live stream and you're just like, have you played a video game before?
That wasn't quite that many.
I mean, and so I think one of the things was like, I don't really know how food in this game works, right? So you land on your colony and there's like a bunch of these resources sort of scattered around the map. And I thought that like, oh, if I just set like a stockpile zone here that like, and like, yeah, the stockpile is like for everything that I thought like the Rimworld Pond colonists would be smart enough to go out and like pick stuff up and put it there. But that doesn't really seem to be the case. And when you were looking at my base, you were like, look at all these like food packs and stuff they have scattered around the map. No wonder all of your colonists are starving. You gotta get your food production in a way. So like
that was just hauling the food back to your base. You had nobody hauling stuff.
Well, yeah. That's a whole other thing. So
is it that they weren't hauling, or that like they weren't? It wasn't set to allow to haul.
Yeah, it is really weird that when you land, like all of the items that come with you are immediately set to like forbid, do not touch. Like, not sure why that is the default. It seems like they should be defaulted to, these are the important items. Like, the first thing I do in any run is unforbid literally everything that they have forbidden. I've never found that to be, like, a useful thing.
Now, you gotta leave silver and gold on the ground and don't put it in the zone, because otherwise you'll inflate your wealth, and that's just
all right, all right. Pro tip. Pro tips with Will here. Excellent. Continue with your story.
Yeah, so is the idea that, like, all right, if someone's jumping into RimWorld for the first time with, like, let's say zero colony sim experience, or, like, anything remotely close to that, like, you know, I see that this game, RimWorld, is, like, one of like the highest rated games on Steam pretty consistently. It's very popular. I want to jump in, but they don't really have much experience with it. Like, they should start with the tutorial, yes? Or is there like a series of mods that they should pick up, or like go and watch YouTube videos? I guess I'm still like also in that state of like, I don't really know like what the not quote unquote optimal early game is, but like, I don't know how to feed my people. Like, it seems kind of like a critical.
I feel like you just build a farm and have a stove. Those are the two things that are important. Once you get there, like you'll land with enough food to last you through when your first crop harvest comes in,
which they will eat so long as it's in the hall zone. HUL, not the dining hall.
You mean their prepackaged food?
Yeah.
Yeah, they'll haul it to the zone, and then they'll go grab it, and they'll go sit at a table.
Just wanted to make sure. Of course, maybe another step I was missing.
Yeah, and you just like make a zone with some farming, set it to make potatoes, and potatoes will grow, and then they'll cook them into meals, simple meals, and your people will be filled.
Yeah,
thrilled, but they will be filled.
Yeah, you want about 20 plots per pawn. If you're going to go pure vegetarian, if you're going to have meat, then you go 10 plots per pawn. And it doesn't matter if you go rice, potatoes, or corn. Rice is a 6-day maturity. Potatoes is 12, and corn is 22. It doesn't really matter. Corn is has the highest yield and for the least amount of effort. But it's also on the field the longest. So there's all these things you learn about, like, oh, well, in the beginning, you want to plant a little bit of each and then slowly transition over to corn, because that rice has got to be ready in 6 days. And that's when your stove is built. And that's when you can start eating good food and you have to eat the packaged stuff. And the game teaches you this, though, as you die over and over again, and you realize, oh, that was a really shit base design right there. I shouldn't have used wood. Oh, I needed larger rooms because everyone's complaining about the how cramped it was. Oh, I needed this and that. Like, this guy was walking 10, like, way inefficiently from this side of the map to that side. Like, you just kind of learn. And so, for me, I think that learning is the fun of the game. And, like, I think once you start dying, like, dying will make the game more fun for you. So if you're not dying, turn the difficulty up and then start dying.
Okay.
And then you'll have a good time because you're like, oh, well, I just got punished real hard because I wasn't prepared for the mechanoid cluster. I didn't have siege ability set up. No, I know I need to have siege on my research early on. And so these are the things.
These are the things. To your point, yes, the losing is part of the fun. Two times I was distinctly having a good time. that I specifically remember was like, ooh, I'm feeling that fun hit in my brain space, was when the pet monkey that had landed with my crew was, which, you know, I don't know. I was telling someone about this. I this might be inaccurate. There's like an option to build a doggy door or like a pet door, right?
Flap.
But since I had a monkey, the monkey was just using the normal front door, which like makes sense to me. Like, no, but anyway, so the monkey who had like some fun, like mundane, like human name, I can't remember. But anyway, when that monkey got attacked by like a wild cat and was like fighting the wild cat, and then I had to, and then all the colony had to come together and defend the monkey. Like, that was like a very fun, enjoyable experience. And then like, I was trying to tame. We didn't kill the wildcat. I'm like, oh, maybe we can tame the wildcat.
Oh, you tried to tame it?
Unfortunately,
early on? Oh,
failed
no.
to do that, and we also failed to save the monkey. And so it was a it was a delightfully entertaining mess. Yeah. So there's, I agree that there's fun in difficulty, and Rimworld does a good job of making that losing enjoyable, which is very good indeed. Now, Scott, I had a similar experience to like the confusion of how to feed people. I had confusion about how to hunt. Once I realized, oh, the crops are taking a long time to grow because obviously, you know, they need sun and they need time. I thought, oh, well, I better have, in the meantime, while I'm waiting for the crops to grow, I should have someone go out and hunt and we can eat meat in the meantime, as much as it hurts me to say that as a vegan. We can have somebody go out and hunt the cyber gobbler, the cyber turkey or whatever, the space turkey. And so I had a bit of a difficult time figuring out, like, I just assumed like once I give the hunt command, like it'll go and I won't have to worry about it. But no, there was like a, you know, there were other steps that needed to be taken. Like I needed to designate that, you know, the dead animals should be hauled, and I needed to go to my haul zone and designate that the haul zone, you were allowed to put dead things there. And then I also needed to have like a butcher area, and
you need to set it so you butchers forever, so that it doesn't like,
yeah, the bill,
it doesn't like butcher three creatures and you're like, well, I'm done butchering forever.
Yeah, so the bills, should you just set it to forever? I was like,
yeah,
reluctant to do that because I thought, oh no, maybe it'll like use up my food stores.
Most of the other stuff,
or something.
Yeah, most of the other stuff do forever is bad, but for butchering, that's what I
do forever.
Okay. Yeah, because you're basically, there's no reason you'd ever want to have a thing that you've hunted down, and then you're just like, well, my job here is done.
Might as well let it rot. Well, unless you like specifically start up like a custom modded scenario where you're doing like, I don't know, Texas Chainsaw Massacre or something. Interesting. Well, that's kind of an annoying design choice, but a design lapse perhaps. Interesting.
Well, how'd you fix that?
Well, I guess in the case of the butchery thing, like maybe there shouldn't be a bill. There should just be like, you're always doing that. But I don't know, would there be a situation where you might, you know, want to hold off if you're in like Arctic freezing conditions? Like maybe, I don't know, maybe there's something I'm overlooking as a noob.
I mean, it could be something as simple as like, for that specific station, when you build it, it comes with that bill automatically set. Like that is the default, is butcher creature forever. And you can turn it off if you want, but
I think we're describing the system that, and I guess we'll come to it in a little bit later when we talk about similar games specifically, but we were recommended by one of our listeners to check out the, I guess it's kind of a colony sim, but maybe more of like a city builder sim, if there's a difference, Against the Storm. And I was noodling around with it, and like I think that's kind of what Andrew's describing, is like you build a building, and instead of like in Rimworld, you build the butcher table, and you have to go into the butcher table, and you have to say, oh, I need like either set this to like repeat forever or do this X number of times. And Against the Storm, it's like you build this building, and it's just like it's auto doing it for you, basically.
I guess I just brought it up as like a lot of this this podcast, I'm trying to be objective and trying not to dip too much into my like sort of personal opinion, because again, I recognize that this is a good game. It's just maybe not a good game for my brain.
No, I disagree. You should get into your personal opinion. If you don't like it, I mean, I didn't like Enter the Gungeon.
Well, I did want to level like one bit of, you know, practical criticism, which is like, well, if two veteran players agree, you should just always have it set to butcher infinitely. Then like, maybe that should be updated. It should not have the bill option. But I mean, the other tables, it seems like the bills make sense. Like with the food, it's like, well, you got to designate what type of food, what level of meals you want made and things like that. So that kind of, that part made sense to me, though it was a little bit annoying to have to keep checking that.
But, no, I agree. I think there should be probably some settings that are like the default settings that you can opt out of, like in the main screen setting, like where it's like, yeah, when you make your first butcher station, it automatically has the bill to do this. When you make your first stove, it automatically has it set to like build 10 simple meals and like just that. And like maybe there should just be settings outside of this so that every time you start a new game, you're not always having to reset these bills. Or it's like put a corpse zone or an animal's corpse stockpile zone directly adjacent to the butcher table whenever you put that down. Like, yeah, these are all, I think, reasonable things. As someone who likes a little bit more customization, because that's not always what you want to be doing, like, yeah, eventually you would change that stuff, but as a default for new players, probably much easier to get into if that's there. I agree.
Fortunately, once you start getting a handle on it, it sounds like, yeah, it comes pretty sick.
Yeah, I don't even think about this stuff anymore. So this is like, it's interesting to hear you guys both say, oh, I was confused by this or that.
Actually,
like, so
wait.
I read on Reddit, like, oh, you got to watch out. Everyone's going to get sick if, like, someone was describing a situation where, like, everybody died because, like, they didn't clean up all of the gore and, like, the charnel piles of filth. So I was like watching for that, but it seemed like, I don't know, it never became an issue. And just to be safe, I like put the butcher area like outside. So I don't know. Do you have to do that? Do you have to like, or when is it an issue that there's like too much butchered blood that you need to?
Oh, it's always an issue. As soon as you get your first food poisoning, and like, especially if you have low level cooks, you're going to have lots of food poisoning. And if you have a lot of gore from the butcher station next to the kitchen, or people running through that area because you make it a high traffic zone, then you make it so that you're going to have lots of food poisoning, which is high reduced speed, lots more they have to eat. They just suck basically for a day and a half.
I'm glad I put it in the back alley then.
Yeah.
Whew. Butcher's Alley, classic.
So one thing I was excited to see in Rimworld versus Dwarf Fortress is that, like, in the world gen system, like, you see, like, your globe is generated and all of, like, the other little sieves are populated on there. One thing that kind of blew my mind was being able to, like, send people from your town, effectively, out to other towns, not even just on, like, little quests or missions, but from what I can tell, like, you can explore all of those other areas on the map. Is that right?
Yeah. I have not found it to be like particularly rewarding to do so, but you can. I guess maybe it's better now than it used to be. I haven't done any of the like let's be raiders type of deal, but you can attack other settlements and stuff if you want.
Yeah, I never got into it either. I think it's It for me, like the tower defense sort of element of the game is much more fun. And just forming a colony and making all the decisions about who all is going, what kind of supplies, how they, far are they going, am I going to be okay until they get back, and like all that stuff was just like a lot of mental overhead. Like those decisions for me just didn't feel that fun. And then all that happens on the over, like the overworld, is that like the little dot that is them, you see them moving out there, they get there, either there's an event that takes place where they don't, you don't have to zoom in, or you zoom in and you essentially usually have to like kill something, or you do a trade, and then you have to form your, reform your caravan, send it back. And it's just like, oh my God, let me do a invest 1,000 clicks in this little like caravan run that just is not, it's not as effective as just like, being back at home and just making sure that they're cleaning up the butcher spot after they butcher something.
And growing flake.
And growing flake, yes. Or Yayo, or Smokeleaf, or all.
I mean,
of
flake is the most cost effective. That's, I mean, Yayo is fine and all, but just not as effective.
Well, Yayo is for the colonists. Flake is for the outsiders.
Oh, that's fair enough.
So, Will, you've dabbled a little bit with the DLCs. I think we kind of touched on them, but there's three of them, each one released one per year the past few years. So I wonder actually if we're going to get one for 2023 or if they're going to start doing other stuff. But in 2020 we had Royalty, which is like royal titles, psychic powers, imperial tech, and new quests. 2021 we had Ideology, which brought along belief systems, social roles, rituals, more quests,
psionics.
And 2022, last year, was biotech, where, Will, you mentioned being able to generate children, feasting on their flesh, genetic modification, and mechanoid boss fights. Like, all of these things sound, like, wild and crazy, but I know that there's, like, so there's the DLCs, which are, like, bottomless in and of themselves. But there's also a pretty extensive mod scene to this game.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, Colin, you're nodding your head in agreement. I have not checked out any of the mods. I don't think Andrew and I have gone down.
Well, actually, initially when I was feeling like, oh, really cataclysm about the situation initially, I was like, oh, I need something to spice it up. I hear there's mods. And so I downloaded this is very clever. The mod is called Grimworld because it's a Warhammer 40,000 mod, which adds like a custom scenario where you're like Imperium of man, like colonizers basically, and you're being sent off to a planet to like make it part of the Imperium, and it adds little aesthetics to basically to make it look kind of like Warhammer. And so like you start off like with the gear that you start with is like a bunch of like army military outfits and laser rifles and chain swords and things, and that was kind of fun. I only did like one kind of brief run with that, but anyway, yeah, lots of mods I was seeing. Holy moly.
Yeah, there's some, like, I know the I imagine the biotech mod took, or DLC took a little bit of the wind out of some of the sales, but there were a lot of mods before that were attempting to do that without having the true like back support. So maybe those mods are even better now that you can, there's true support for implementing like weird different species and furries and whatnot. But
so like what do the biomods do exactly? It's like you get a bionic arm and you're better at arm related tasks, or like what is it? What happens?
Oh, no. I mean, this is like different species. Like, oh, there's one, okay. Like one of the big ones I saw was like dinosaur stuff. They put dinosaurs in it and they're like, you could make human dino hybrids and all that fun stuff. But I think it was like a little bit clunky. I never actually like played around with it extensively. But it was trying to do something that the system wasn't really built to do. Mm-hmm. Versus now that the biotech mod is, or DLC has come out, that is literally doing, it has implemented a like back end for what these modders were trying to do. So I'm sure that in the next year or maybe now, they'll be able to take all their previous work and make it like much better with the specifically the back end for different species and different hybrid things and whatnot, genes, etc.
Yeah.
So I'm sure that people are people are pretty passionate about a lot of these mods. They're put real amounts of work into it. So
sure. And from a newcomer's perspective, it was super easy to install mods. So
yeah,
appreciate that. Thank you, Steam Workshop / thank you devs.
Yeah, there was a really cool mod years ago. It was like a Mars colony like a Mars landing simulator, but like 2026 level technology or something, like very near future, very realistic. But then it, like the creator stopped updating it, and it didn't stay in sync with the Rimworld like version control, and so it stopped working, which was disappointing because it was like a really weird. It was like the most accurate Mars landing simulator that I've played, and it was not an actual game. It was just a mod for Rimworld. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah, my modding experience is very light. I mean, honestly, there's so much content just in the game itself. Like, even without these DLCs, there's just so much in there. Like, all I did was prepare carefully, basically. And I think I did, at some point, I was doing a animals only sort of run where I just had one colonist that just tamed everything, and that way it was
neat.
Yeah, and that's a fun way of playing too, but like that I had different, like I think some animal expansion there, but I think yeah, prepare carefully is really the only one that I paid a lot of attention to.
No, wait,
some scores?
Say,
oh,
I just real briefly, I was curious on the topic of mods. Is there any kind of like, this would have to be like some kind of aftermarket, like messing around with, you know, some some of the core files and stuff. Does this game have multiplayer? Is there a multiplayer mod, or like, I have no idea how it would work, but like, is there any kind of co-op or versus? And then my other question is like, would it be fun as like a versus RTS game? Question mark.
I don't think it would, because time stops whenever the player has complete control over that. And so you'd have to do both in real time. And so if you try to do both in real time, like, I don't know, it'd become, I guess, yeah, like sort of a StarCraft-esque game where you're trying to micro a whole bunch of craziness happening at once. I don't know.
One thing that's kind of common in the Dwarf Fortress world is save sharing, where like you build something up and then you like you save your save world kind of a thing. And like either someone takes over from where you're at, or like you build up something to try to go invade that person's fort. Like, yeah, I'm not sure really multiplayer would work per se, but I imagine like if, for example, Will built up like this really super stronghold base and then was able to pass the save over to me, I think you can do this in Rimworld, check me if I'm wrong, but then I would be able to say, okay, I'm on this world, Will's base is on there, I'm gonna start a new base and try to go and invade it. Is that something that you can do?
I'm not sure.
I can imagine like some sort of weird asynchronous thing where it's like once per season you send a raid out to like try and attack the other person's base, and you're kind of like explicitly doing like micro versus macro something. I don't know if you could just do like the normal game as a multiplayer and have it be like super fun, but you know, people, from a brief Google search just now, it looks as if there are mods that claim to be multiplayer-esque. I don't know.
Interesting.
Being able to do it and having it be a fun, enjoyable experience are two different things.
And then another question that is on the same topic, the topic of combat. Would this game be better for new people if there was a Cataclysm safe mode auto pause? That was so infuriating previously. Because every time I got attacked, like it came as a surprise because I wasn't paying attention to the message.
That's the game teaching you to build zones.
There's a barbarian madman here.
I mean, that is the game teaching you to build zones. Like for your animals, if you don't want them wandering all over the map, you have to build a zone to keep them in it, or a pen. And so as soon as you do that, then you don't have that kind of encounter where your prized bonded animal is getting killed.
Sure, it usually has a pop-up that something's happening.
Yeah, there's always a pop-up. It's not, this isn't like a complaint per se. It just made, gave me pause, and I was like, well, you know, maybe Cataclysm was onto something there.
You get the pop-up, you're like,
an option.
Andrew is being hunted by a polar bear. Be like, what? Andrew, you better run back to the... Oh, no, the polar bear is faster than you. Oh, God, he's eating Andrew. Well, maybe we'll be... Nope. Oh, we can't even recover the corpse.
Ripperoo. Indeed. Yeah, well, there you have it. And that's what the experience playing this game is like. It's like being eaten alive by a Coca-Cola mascot. And that's a pretty good review.
High on flake.
So sorry, I cut off. Somebody was suggesting that we might go into rankings. Two
ratings, yes. Indeed. Maybe I'll start first, because who knows how long my 4G tether will last here. But yeah, I thought this game was good. It was kind of an insane week for me, so I felt like I didn't have an opportunity to dump as many hours into it as I wanted. But it definitely had that pull to it of like, ooh, I should go back to the game and try this, versus our Cataclysm experience, which was like me feeling like a pit in my stomach of like, oh my God, like I got to go back and like try to do something here. I guess maybe I'll try, and really fighting that urge. So it was very much like pulling me in its direction, which was good. I think the tutorial mode I'll say is worth checking out. I think it gives you enough of an onboarding to kind of get started. The visuals and like the UI and the UX involved like is a big deal. I think like it doesn't get talked about enough when games do good UI. And for all of the complexity that's going on in this game, it's kind of a triumph that there's like very simple, very straightforward menus of things to like point and click with a mouse and not using Vim keys to do so. That's a welcome experience. I mostly played my time this past couple weeks on the Steam Deck, and the fact that it's like natively playable on there is like mind blowing. And it's actually not a bad experience. Like I would expect like, oh, the font size will be super small, it'll like chug really hard. No, like it played really, really well. Like I was very shocked about that. So I think like top to bottom, the game is like really well engineered. The music in this game is really good. It's very fitting to the theme, I think. The build copy button is an absolute lifesaver from Dwarf Fortress days. But and yeah, things like the community and like the wiki are all so like highly skillfully engineered that this is a game that, yeah, if you're remotely interested in this kind of topic, I think you'll get a lot of value of. I think my only kind of gripe with this is that some of the things are a little like terse for newbies, but I think it's like once you get over that hump, you're like, oh, okay, I got it. And then I think the theme is a little weird, where it's like, I think the Tynan Sylvester, the creator, the D&D name guy, was saying that it's like very Firefly inspired, which I like. It kind of like, I'm like, okay, I think I get it in terms of like dusters and cowboy hats, but like M16s and like Uzis with space travel seem a little incongruous to me. Maybe I'm just nitpicking, but like maybe I'm looking more for like one of those Warhammer Total Conversion mods, or like the Kenshi one, if there's one from like the Expanse universe, I feel like that would theme really well in here. So yeah, I don't know. I like space western stuff, I'm on, but I think all the rest of the stuff like kind of ticks all the right boxes, and I can totally see myself spending a lot more time with this in the future too. So for me, it's going to clock in at my number 6 game that we've reviewed so far out of 34, just ahead of Monster Train and just behind Binding of Isaac Rebirth. Again, this is something that I feel like that ranking might change over time if I like spend more time with it. I'd be like, oh my God, this game's amazing 500 hours later. But I think after my brief experience, like top 5, 6, that's not so bad.
Wrong.
I mean, that's out of a list of almost 40. We're getting close to 40. That's quite good.
Yeah, I'll go next. We'll alternate between noobs and pros. So I know Will is going to be angry about this. I'm going to rank this as our number 4 game on our podcast list. despite it being one of my top five favorite games of all time, I think that it is the best game that we've played so far in terms of how much I like the game. I don't think it is the best roguelike game. I think that if you are treating this solely as trying to find a roguelike experience out of it, it's a pretty good game. But my favorite parts of it, and the way I've been playing it in the last 2 weeks has been trying to like push the difficulty so that it is a true roguelike experience where you're losing often. And I find it like, I still like it a lot. I think it's still a really good game. There are parts of it that get a little bit repetitive, like doing the intro based setup thing more than once. You're like, well, I've already done this. It's not different enough to be like super thrilling. And I like the mid game or late game more, which by the time you get to that point, it is less of a roguelike and more like a city builder or something like that. So I think it is a really good game. Simulation games are my jam. And I know Will and I have talked about, like, if I was given $1 billion and said, hey, go like give this money to someone to make a video game, my ultimate video game would be basically this, but ant themed. I want like I think that an ant theme is the actual perfect theme for a colony simulator, like a weird fantasy ant simulator where they're like intelligent ant creature things. I think that would be so fucking cool. That's not going to get made, but I would love it. I'm going to say number four for roguelikes, number one so far out of games that we've played in terms of just sheer how much I like the game, because I love Rimworld.
Right on. Fantasy ant, that's a very popular search term in certain corners of the internet. So I was playing, and at one point of my sort of longest playthrough, a wild man showed up, just some hulking goon wandering around. But, you know, hey, he wasn't hurting anybody. He wasn't stealing too much stuff. And so it just kind of let him hang around. And after a few days, he got friendlier. And by golly, he joined up. And he started helping out around the colony. It turned out he was actually pretty good at building stuff. So I thought that, and that gave me quite a bit of joy. And I thought that was very entertaining, very simple, but like, again, a fun little, you know, interaction, all these different complex systems working together to provide a unique, fun experience of my, you know, my ragtag group of colonists trying to survive on this planet. I see a lot of myself in that wild man. And it taught me that, you know, even a Neanderthal such as myself can find enjoyment in a game such as this. And though it was not as the enjoyment wasn't as easily acquired, and it wasn't as often that I was having big jumps of fun, I still, you know, enjoyed my experience with Rimworld. My ranking is like, I mean, if I was ranking this purely based on like, oh, is it my favorite game, the most fun I've had, it'd be pretty low. But I think in terms of like how objectively like good and impressive, like what an achievement this game is, I think it is just that. It's quite an impressive, as like a student of game history and like game design and stuff, I think Rimworld is quite an impressive game. And so I'm putting it at number four on my list.
All right. Well, prepare yourselves for the correct answer here. Yeah, so Rimworld, it is tied for first place of all games ever made with Factorio, Slay the Spire, Kerbal Space Program, and Kenshi. I can't say which is the best of all these, because each of them are perfect games in their own way. and the only games I've ever awarded the 10 out of 10 rating to out of literally hundreds in my list.
What about Kerbal Space Program?
Kerbal got
Kerbal Space Program was a 10 out of 10. What do you mean?
Did you say that?
I did say that.
Not to worry. Good looking out
there. Not to worry. It's on the list. Don't worry. It is on the list. But yeah, Rimworld is, 580 hours. I mean, that speaks for something here. And I think it's just such a diverse, there's so much content in the game. There's such a diverse number of approaches you can take to the game. There's so many weird, zany things you can do, so many weird, zany ways you can die. And now with the new DLC, there's just so much in there. And for me, opening it up, like every time I get, like, there's always a new goal that emerges. There's always a new pathway of achieving that goal. And I think really, if I had to boil down the essence of what makes this game fun for me, it's this, it's like an intensely scientific sort of problem. You're constantly presented with questions, and you have to form hypotheses. Like for instance, like even just on this playthrough, this is the first time I've really thought, like, how much food do I actually need for each pawn? Like at a bare minimum. And like, what's the optimal amount of food to plant? What's the optimal cycle of food to plant? Like at which points as you begin the game, like what's the build order you need to do? And so this is something that can be answered with enough analysis. And so I just love that this game pulls me out of actually playing the game into spreadsheets where I'm trying to figure this stuff out. I feel so inspired to be like, I need to know. Like, what is the right? And I actually have a huge spreadsheet that's figuring out, like, okay, well, this plant, this much rice, this much potatoes, this much corn. On this day, you switch from rice to, and it's just like, it's so satisfying when it works. And I just fucking love it. And then you just have the constant questions. How do I do this? How do I do that? What's the optimal way of doing this? Oh my goodness. I just want to spark up some Rimworld right now and just, you know, just get that flake directly, up the nose.
Skip it, go straight to Excel.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Excel, the ultimate. No, Excel's, we're in G sheets now. That's how you do these modern things, but you want to be able to share and collaborate. In fact, I think I built a Rimworld spreadsheet or a G sheet like 4 or 5 years ago, for Prepare Carefully, where I put this, like really complex, like here is the results of, like, if you have choose three colonists, these are the ideal three based on all of the thousands of reasons. And like, this is something I posted, and it's fun. Even to this day, I can go onto that spreadsheet and there's still people on there getting information about how to make prepare carefully, like pawns perfect. And I love that about that, the community there. And I love that there's a lot of other inquisitive minds out there who want to really maximize. So that's, 10 out of 10. What else is there to say? It is a maximum game and you all should play it.
Which means, sorry, did you officially state it's number one game by far,
folks. I mean, Luck Be a Landlord is now slid into number two, and in terms of like, and then we have War Sim after that, and it's just like, well, Rimworld is just so far above, like, I mean, in terms of its content and replayability, like in terms of raw fun you experience while playing the game, yeah, they're all pretty similar, I think. But Rimworld just has just so much more reliable dopamine that lasts five. Like, there's not 580 hours worth of content in Luck Be a Landlord or War Sim. So, like, yeah, that's why it's getting a 10 out of 10 here. All right. Number one rating.
Right on. Just want to make sure we got enough fanfare on that. Number one.
Got to make it official. Yeah. Well. That's going to make Rimworld our overall number two game of the podcast so far.
After what?
It's just after FTL Faster Than Light. And
oh, you guys.
Monster Train, finally. Monster Train has been demoted to number three.
Oh, my word.
But yeah, so if you are interested in Rimworld or Rimworld adjacent things, obviously we've talked a lot about Dwarf Fortress a lot. Colin, I think you mentioned Prison Architect as
kind of similar. It's kind of similar. It's definitely stylistically, like the visuals were a direct inspiration.
One that I've kind of had my eye on just because it seems so absurd is Timberborn, the beaver Dwarf Fortress simulator.
Also which... delightful.
Yeah, that's a good one.
But I do have a short list here of games that I think this is a growing new genre of the rogue spectrum of games that are colony builders, but more explicitly trying to get into the rogue format. So we briefly touched on Against the Storm earlier. That's worth calling out again. Just very recently released in the past few days is a game called Dot Age, which is like, it's a pun on the old man character that you play as, but it's like, what if Dwarf Fortress, but Super Nintendo graphics, which seems very interesting and delightful. There's another one, Keeper RL. We got, what else on those lists? Kingdom New Lands is kind of another one. One that's kind of come up a couple times, which I'm kind of scared about, is something called Rattropolis. But Colin, to your point about bugs, we got bugs. I'm from Buenos Aires, kill them all. There's a game on Steam called Buggos.
Oh, go on.
Which, give it a quick search. I believe is kind of exactly what you were describing 5 minutes ago.
Wait, well, not it? It's not quite, I think.
Oh, there we go. Two G's, Buggos. I mean, I can tell already from looking at the graphics, there aren't going to be enough ants getting their heads ripped off by enemy mandibles. I want StarCraft 1 level graphics of like true grit. Uh-huh. I mean, I am the guy who has the ants textbook and read it for fun. And ants are fucking metal, dude. They're so brutal. I want a brutal one. I want them to be like spitting acid in each other's faces and like parasitizing the queen and supplanting them via like mind control drugs. And I want like a weird, like Kenshi or Morrowind like level, like kind of alien feel to it. But I will look at Buggos a little bit more.
Well, I guess that's going to wind down our Rimworld episode here. If you want to write into the show and suggest some stuff for us to check out, email us at grogpodzone@gmail.com. We are on Mastodon at grogpod. You'll know the one. And then our website is grogpod.zone, where you can find all of our other episodes and rankings and fun stuff. Andrew, what's our game that we're looking at for next time?
Well, Scott, you, I think it can be safely said, axolotl questions. We're going to be playing AK-xolotl, as in an axolotl wielding an AK-47. I'm talking roguelite, top down, shooting it up, shmups, not a shmups, but a twin stick shooter, which has some fun art and has been getting pretty favorable reviews, recently released this year, I believe.
Sweet. Let's lock and load. Yeah, I think that'll be fun to play, getting back into the Gungeon style action. But for this episode, to play us out from our frontier Rimworld colony on the rim of the galaxy, are some lo-fi rim beats for you to get your flake production up and running.